There are three readings today. The first is from Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 to 9. Hear, O Lord, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. The second reading is from Matthew 5. Verses 43 to 48. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbour and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. And the final reading is from Mark 12, verses 28 to 34. One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, of all the commandments, which is the most important? The most important one, answered Jesus, is this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this. Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. Well said, teacher, the man replied. You are right in saying that God is one, and there is no other but him. To love him with all your heart, with all your understanding, and with all your strength, and to love your neighbour as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, you are not far from the kingdom of God. And from then on, no one dared ask him any more questions. Amen.
Thank you, Sue. I'm going to start off just by listening to a bit of music. Hopefully it will work okay. And then just going to give a bit of a pause at the end, just a bit of silence before we start looking at these texts. So.
Sometimes while I'm driving, trying to find my song, looking for the answers, and where are they, deaf and dumb like me?
That last statement, are they deaf and dumb like me? And to understand the love of God, you have to understand that you're deaf and dumb to it. You could have a PhD in theology and still be deaf and dumb to the love of God. Because until you know what it is, by looking inside yourself and how much you love yourself, despite when you look outside at others, it's only then that you realize that the love of God is something of a completely different category to the word used within normal human conventions, which is why the Bible points to a cross to explain love. Jesus' words, they are spirit and they are life. That's what should be imparted this morning whenever you're looking at the word, talking to one another. Spirit and life, not knowledge. Wisdom. Knowledge puffs up. Love builds up. These words you hear Jesus says to his hearers are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. So let's just go through these passages. So the first one, Jesus' love. It's deeper than law. Of course, we heard the law at the beginning. The law to love God. The have to, the ought to love God. And then how that is then communicated to children. The new covenant's different. God himself says so. I'll remove your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. I'll put my word in you so that nobody needs to teach you. We're recipients on this side of the cross of the new covenant. The love of God is not something we have to or ought to do. And that deaf and dumbness, so to speak, the blindness to it is when you realize that there's no way you can love God. You just cannot through will and effort, through obedience. You can only return to God the love that he's poured into you by his Spirit. So Jesus' love is deeper than law. Grace and truth comes through Jesus. The law comes through Moses. And human beings are very good at rules and law. And for all of the merits, and there was tons yesterday, and I don't want to detract from that, there was a massive error made, in my book anyway. There was a statement that King Charles III would obey God's law and the gospel. The gospel makes the law obsolete. That's what happens when the church gets power, when religion gets power. Somehow, language, institution, rules, regulations, procedures to enforce law, rules through power has to be sought out and established. There were wonderful words in the sermon yesterday about servant leadership, hanging on a cross, God's love, the crown being one of thorns. It was mentioned that he humbled himself, becoming nothing, even to death on a cross. Kenosis, the emptying of his godness, something that he didn't see fit to exercise. And yet a lot of the procedures with the sword and everything was about the enforcement of law. And this tension in front of a billion people plus of grace and law still being connected together. I wonder whether your experience of Christianity and understanding is reflected by that. That you still see part of Christian experience as obedience to law. Externally trying your best because you agree with it to try and be the best Christian you can, when all the while it's written on your hearts and yielding to the Holy Spirit's direction, you will not sin in the way that you would if you're trying not to. The strength comes, but also the love for yourself when you fall short, rather than the response of law, disappointment, judgment of yourself. You see, you can't love other people unless you love yourself. And you can't love yourself until you understand how God loves you. So here we have the law mentioned in Mark, the greatest commandment. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Second is this, love the your neighbor as yourself. There's no commandment greater than these. Interesting, in Luke, he's asked by the Pharisee or the Sadducee, I can't remember which one it is now, teacher of the law. And he says, how do you read the law? And it's the Sadducee that says it. The Pharisee, the scribe who says it. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commands. Everything in the Old Testament, everything hangs on love. And what these mean. And in Matthew, it's down here. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy, according to the law. Well, it doesn't explicitly say that, but this is what Jesus is saying in terms of normal procedures, human protocols, in terms of who do you love and who you don't. And what Jesus means here and understands the commandment is taken to the ultimate level. There is nobody that is disqualified from our love. Nobody. Most of all ourselves. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you might be children of your Father in heaven. Interestingly, when the teacher of the law has said, yes, you've said well, and then basically repeats what Jesus said, Jesus says, yeah, you're not far from the kingdom. He didn't say you got it. Why? Because he knew the guy didn't. Because it was an external rule still to that guy. So he was not far from the kingdom, pointed in the right direction like so many of us, but actually not quite getting it. How important is this? What really is the greatest commandment? Is it the first or second? It's the second. Because that's what Paul says. You see, love is deeper, deeper than law. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another, for whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other commands there may be are summed up in this one command. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul. No. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. You see, you can't love God unless you love your neighbor as you love yourself in the way that God is intending it. That's the only explanation, isn't it? That this, the first greatest commandment would be dropped to the second one being like the first one, and the second one being able to describe the first one. In James, it's called the royal law. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. Not the doing, not the observance of the law, the fulfillment of it, the completion of it. Why? Because it's a state of being. It's a state of identity. It's not an activity. The activity is an expression of something much deeper. In Galatians, Paul says this, serve one another humbly in love, for the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one commandment, love your neighbor as yourself. Have you ever noticed that? The greatest commandment as Jesus was tested, which could only go as far as getting you near the kingdom, is superseded by a different comprehension. And understanding who Jesus is, what the cross is all about, what the resurrection is all about, what your true identity and destiny, your reality really is. So Jesus' love is an internal work of discovery. eternal work of a discovery. So let's just draw some of those statements from Jesus and Paul. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. Love does no harm to self. Of course, the obvious issue in terms of harming self is the problems that we see and know about, those tragic situations where somebody feels that they the need to physically do that. But how many of us are doing that to ourselves all the time, in the way we think about ourselves, the way we measure ourselves against others, even to the point if we think we're okay and better than others or achieved something, we're injuring ourselves because it's probably not what God wants us to see and think. We're just playing the pecking order game in our cultural protocols, in our circles of what's accepted and what is seen as good and wants to be pursued, something to take hold of. So we move to the first epistle of John, who's got a lot to say about love. I've made you known to them, Jesus says, as he prays to the Father, and will continue to make you known. Jesus has made God known and will continue to make known. Why? So we can establish some brilliant Christian institutions and some great confessions of faith and doctrinal protocols and things like that. No, what does he say? We'll continue to make them known in order that the love you have for me may be in them. It's the whole point. The whole point of you sitting here this morning listening to me, so that God's love may be in you. Because what you have to offer is love from the cradle just won't cut it. It won't cut it for you, your neighbor, or the world outside, but God's love will. And you're capable of receiving that, because it says in Romans chapter 5 that hope doesn't disappoint us. Why? Because he has poured his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. It's an internal thing unless you turn inside spiritually and start seeing your poverty in terms of what you can achieve without Christ, even if you think it's with Christ, but it's just some sort of convention, some Christian tradition that seems to have all the hallmarks, but it never changes you, never heals you. In fact, however you judge yourself by those rules, you will inevitably end up judging others by. Goes on to say, we know that we have passed from death to life because we love each other. Let that sink in. What a litmus test. Do you know whether you've passed from death to life? Life in all of its fullness is why the shepherd came. You know whether you love because you know that you have that life in you. Not intellectually, not in terms of just a theological concept, but you know that you know that you know that you know that you know. Just like the blind man would say, look, I don't know what you guys are saying. All I know is I was blind, but now I can see. Your families, your friends, your neighborhoods, your nation, your planet need you and me to know this love and not settle for anything less. No religious nonsense. Anyone who does not love remains in death. Not will do, but does. Obviously, this is a metaphor, isn't it? There's something about the fact that exercising human love corresponds to death. Probably because it's actually not a selfless giving love, but it's a one with strings attached. It's a self-serving love. An internal work of discovery. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment in this. In this world, we are like Jesus. You can, apparently. You can be right now, because of your Christian walk, like Jesus. Has what you've been practicing made you like Jesus? If it hasn't, stop that and do whatever it does. Because God has been all through your life trying to get you to see and practice whatever it is that takes to become like Jesus. And if whatever you've been doing has got a massive Christian label on it, and it hasn't made you like Jesus, it is not what the Holy Spirit's been trying to do in your life or mine. It's so simple. It's so obvious. But it takes tons of courage. It takes the same type of courage that if you've had a Damascus Road experience conversion, that you suddenly changed because you had the motivation that you couldn't deny, that actually it sent out ripples in your family, your friends, your workmates. I experienced that. It took courage for me to see through what it was all about. It takes courage to stop a Christian practice, which others may think is perfectly all right. But if it's not forming Christ in you, it's no good to you, your family, your neighbors, or this world, and it's not what God intends. It's as simple as that. Have you passed from death to life? Do you know the love of God in your hearts? Have you gone inside and realized the poverty that's there, that you just cannot follow Jesus? You can't. You've tried and tried and tried, but you just can't. You're confused by the things that happen around you in life, which you wonder what sort of God that is to allow it. And it doesn't sort of meet up with the sort of idea that you've got of God, but you just put it to one side because you just practice the same tradition and all the right lines come out to try and smother it and just dilute it away, rather than you going, it doesn't make sense. Have you, like the psalmist, you just bare your heart before the Lord and say, where are you? Where are you? Jesus said it for you on the cross. And until you connect with that statement by him, he was never abandoned by God. It says further down in the psalm he was quoting, but you have not abandoned me. But humanity thinks God's abandoned, so we've spent all of our history trying to create gods that we can actually approach. And they're not very nice. So he approached us. And don't try and make some sort of division between God's love and his holiness and righteousness. I used to do that. That's this law and gospel mistake. His holiness and his righteousness is defined. The point of reference is his love, because that's his being and that was the cross. Jesus shows God's holiness and righteousness in its full entirety. And we saw how he treated people. Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. That's God's holiness and righteousness being exercised. Grace, forgiveness. Why? Because the gods we invent don't really have grace and forgiveness, but rules that need to be met. Otherwise, they're not perfect. And he finally says, there is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment, judgment, right, wrong. I'm not good enough. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. It's just Jesus' love is your reality. It's your identity. It's your purpose. It's your very being. Why? Because you are the image bearer of God. Love as you were created to love. The gospel is the only thing that will help you to understand that. as God who is in you is love. Let's connect that together. Love as you were created to, as God who is in you is love. I was going to just put love, but is love. Love like God loves, because that's the love in you. And you can. Every single one of you can love like God loves. With all of the life that comes, that will involve tears when you're facing terrible circumstances. You won't have to try to love your enemy. You'll find yourself in a situation where you're astonished by the true affection you have for those that you would have once hated. Why? Because you were trying to make your normal human love like them. God, naturally, Jesus, if you took those nails out, his love would have held him on the cross. I've heard that before, sort of defy science, but if you took the nails out, it wasn't the nails that was holding him there, it was his love. And you have that love. You can do it. You can do it. You can change history for your families, for your neighborhood, for the nation. You can do a Christianity which, yeah, you might get persecution. I see there's only two responses in the scripture to authentic Christian witness, and one of them isn't apathy. It's either persecution or attraction. Is that happening in your life? It doesn't happen in my life a lot. As a minister, I go out there, it's more apathy. Was that exercise yesterday? The historian afterwards who was being interviewed, he said, we'll see, because we were actually a secular society. What was that all about? How much of the religious content that was right in your face really was a representation of hearts and souls in the British Isles? What's the reality that the church has to actually engage in? Am I such a lover? Are you such a lover? Drop trying to use human affection and love to try and love your neighbor, yourself, the world around you. God loves you despite. Don't fall into the trap of having to conform your life, your perspective on yourself and people around you according to human conventions. Until you bask in that overwhelming love that despite, I mean, let's face it, God, he's begun a good work that will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. He didn't say, I'm going to love you tons more when I finish my work because you're more lovable than now. No, he's doing the love because of the total 100% love that he has for you. I wonder if your love for yourself matches up for that. That when you get it wrong as a Christian, that you're gentle with yourself and generous. Don't necessarily have to agree with whatever went wrong, but you can say, I must be in the right place because I'm seeing myself as God does. So I wasn't in the right place because I succumb to that temptation. Now I'm in the right place because I'm seeing myself as you see me, Father. Against all odds, I love myself. The next step is that turns outwards to the people around. They don't have to be perfect for you. They don't even have to like you. They don't have to do what you want them to. And you can forgive them for the sin that we all commit. And that is wanting others to be God for us, to be perfect for us, to do what we want them to do, so that we can line all our ducks up in life, everybody doing what we think they ought to, so that our life goes the way it should. So Jesus on the cross, where were his ducks? Love yourself as God loves you. The astonishing thing is, that's the greatest antidote to sinning. Against all odds and all human logic, if you love yourself in the way God does, you will walk the path of righteousness and manifest the fruit of the Spirit. But it's not human love on steroids. It's not some superhuman love. It is an entirely different love. You have access to it. We're told that it's in us. We just need to clear our heads, get scripture right, ask the right questions about what we do, whether it really achieves what it's meant to or not, and then follow Jesus in the way he wants us to. And I am looking at history changers. I'm looking at people that are full of the love of God, full of the Spirit without measure, that will inhabit eternity, that there is no peaks or troughs in terms of honor. You are all going to reign with Christ on his throne, because that's what it says in the book of Revelation. One person deep, billions of people wide, that throne. God can do immeasurably more than you can imagine, let alone ask for. But it starts by that bit that comes before that in Ephesians chapter 3. Ask for the power to know that love. It's dimensions that Sue helpfully prayed about earlier. It's dimensions that can't be measured. To know it, the love that's beyond understanding, so that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you. We thank you that this is not some pragmatic, show me six steps so I can achieve what I think I need to achieve. Thank you that we're not under law, but under grace.